We're talking to David Pleasance, who is what? The sales guy, the head sales guy at Commodore from 1985 to the end. 83
till the very end. Yeah.
Wow. So you've got more than a small handful of stories to tell us.
Yeah, I mean, I have to be honest with you and tell you that those years, 12 and a half years, were the best years of my life.
Yeah, I bet.
Even though there was a lot of tough times, a lot of things went wrong, I absolutely adored it. I couldn't wait to get to work every day. I really couldn't. It was amazing.
And you started at Commodore at a really good time, wasn't it? Shortly after the C64 was launched. And that was such a groundbreaking computer. A bit like the Amiga. It literally sold itself, didn't it?
Yeah, it was. All my life I've been a really lucky person. I've had so much good luck. I've had some pretty rotten luck too, but for a long time I had really good luck. And me getting my job with Commodore was a complete and utter fluke. I mean, I had been living in Australia for quite a long time. And when I left Australia, I deliberately spent 7 weeks traveling the world. By the time I got back to the UK, I was pretty certain that the computer business was going to be big, and in particular home computers. Now remember, in 83 we had no internet. So if you wanted to find a job, you had to look at the newspapers.
Yeah, Thursday's evening
Sundays.
Mail, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, Thursdays and Sundays. And anyway, I started scouring for jobs, anything with the word computer in it, because I knew nothing about computers. Anyway, I found a job advertised through an agency and it had the word computer in it. I didn't really know what it was about. Anyway, I rang this guy up. I got this appointment, so I went to see him. And I remember very clearly, as I arrived at their building, that there was a lady just leaving. So I remember holding the door open for this lady while she left. Anyway, as soon as I walked in, the guy sat me down and said, right, we had the interview. And at the end of the interview, he said, Mr. Pleasant, there's no doubt in my mind that you could do the job that you've applied for standing on your head. But I'm not going to put you forward for it. The thing is, he said, you've got the most incredible retail background that I've ever seen. And he said it would be remiss of me as a recruitment agent to not utilize your skills in the retail industry. And he said, as a matter of fact, he said, did you see a lady leaving? I said, yeah. He said, well, she's just given me a brief for a job that I think would be absolutely perfect for you. He said, I'm not even had a chance to write this job up because he's just left. You normally write it up and do that.
Yeah.
He said, I think you'd be perfect for it. And that was with Commodore. And 3 days after that, I'm in front of the MD at Commodore in Slough, and 2 days after that, I'm working for them. What I asked them to do first is, because I like to do my own thing, and I said, what I'd like to do, because I've been out of the UK for quite a while, I want to do some research on all the retailers and find out who's who, who's the best to deal with, and so on. And it was obvious to me that there was a company then called Lasky's. I don't know if you remember Lasky's.
Where I bought my first computer from,
Lasky's. Yeah, they had 54 stores, and in 26 of those stores, they had a store within the store called MicroPoint. So they were absolutely set up to sell business products. So I went to their head office, spoke to their managing director, got a letter from him allowing me to go and interview the MicroPoint managers, which of course just allowed me to sell into them, pre-sell into them. I was in the 24th store out of 26, and because we had no mobile phones, and Eileen Stradd rang me in that store, luckily I was in where I was supposed to be, and she said, David, do you remember when I interviewed you, I told you that things happened really quickly in Commodore? Yes. She said, well, it's your lucky day. Our 64 sales are going crazy. We need somebody to take over looking after national accounts, and you're it. I wasn't even allowed to do the last two stores for the PET. I had to go straight back and become national
accounts. You joined at a very, very
perfect timing.
Yeah,
absolutely. Because I knew very quickly that Commodore eventually was going to go bust because they'd never had a business plan. I mean, I was recruited to sell PETs, and within 3 months, it was announced that we haven't got anywhere near enough stock to open a new market. They hadn't got enough stock of PETs for me to do what I was recruited to do. So luckily for me, I got the job selling 64s. And I've got to tell you, we got it in everywhere. I mean, we got the 64 in the most ridiculous places. We sold 64 into Boots, a chemist, Tesco's, WH Smith's, newsagents, anywhere and everywhere. We got it into everywhere.
I distinctly remember walking into Boots and WH Smith's, and there was a whole lineup of computers. You had the Texas Instruments, you had the Dragon 32, C64, Spectrum. They were all in there. Great times.
Yeah, were very exciting times. And we kept the 64 alive 2 years beyond its real sell-by date, by what we were doing. The annoying thing from my point of view was that we proved to the corporation that what we were doing was the right thing to do, but they would not insist that all the other European companies did the same.
Yeah. So
every Commodore subsidiary got their own marketing budget, and they spent it however they wanted, which meant that it was such a lot of waste of money. I mean, can you understand that? Doesn't make any commercial sense to me at all.
Well, no. I mean, if you look at, well, what happened after the Amiga was launched, it was the goose that laid the golden egg. The Amiga was, I think, to a lot of people here today, the finest home computer ever made.
Yes.
It changed the bar. I remember seeing it for the first time in Lasky's. I walked into Lasky's, and there was this machine. I'd never seen one before.
Right.
I would have been 15.
Right.
And I saw this Commodore Amiga, and there was, like I said, the demo of the cat walking and the camera panning around.
I'd
never seen anything like it. My jaw hit the floor, and I had to have one.
Mm.
My first wage packet, first thing I bought, Commodore Amiga.
Yeah.
And to me, those feelings, those memories have never gone away. And I think for a lot of people, they think back at the Amiga, and it was such a great time, wasn't it?
I think the truth of the matter is that when the 64 was launched, and shortly after the Amiga, it was the right time for that generation of people who were looking for something new.
Yeah.
And, you know, it wasn't music or fashion. And so when their own computers hit, a lot of people got into that. And so many of those people now have got great jobs in the IT business.
Yeah, because of the Amiga.
Absolutely, yeah. The other reason why I knew Commodore was destined to go bankrupt was that they never had any external auditing. Every subsidiary did their own thing. They had their own budgets and everything else. And every subsidiary would do its forecast. Each quarter would forecast what they were going to sell. Okay? And then at the end of the quarter, you'd report what your sales were, and that's how Commodore operated its business. Now, I can tell you, for example, but if you take Commodore Holland, for example, the general manager there was a guy called Bernard van Tienen, and he was the biggest crook known to man. Now, he used to boast to us, every time we had a meeting, he would boast. Every quarter's end, if he hadn't reached his target, which he hardly ever did, he would invent invoices.
Mm.
He would put product on a truck and send it on a journey for 5 days. So he'd go out of the quarter's end, he'd record the figures, get his bonus and commission, 5 days later he'd bring it back in the stock again. Now, because they never had any auditing, external auditing, they never knew. They recorded
these
sales.
Get away with it, wouldn't
which
you?
Weren't real. So that they never had the money that they thought was there, and that's just one example. I can tell you absolutely without any shadow of a doubt, Commodore UK, we never did anything like that. Everything we did was real.
So after the launch of if we go on to what you've been doing lately, so we all know that after the launch of the CD32, Amiga 1200 sales literally bottomed out, and not long after the release of the Amiga CD32, Commodore were no more.
Yes.
What happened to the brand? And this is what your new book is actually addressing. What happened to Commodore, the brand, after the demise?
Well, it's a subject of, in fact, two volumes of the book, because there's so much in there. When I did the Kickstarter, I promised that I would deliver a book of a similar size and quality as Commodore The Inside Story. When we started doing all the research, there is so much information that we've got, lots of stuff that I didn't know about, nobody knew about.
Well, I know, I think ESCOM were originally involved.
ESCOM, I mean, remember, I was in the courtroom and ESCOM actually bought a bid from the amount.
Mm.
So I was there at the end of the book, of the series, and also at the start. And so this book tells about how ESCOM screwed it up big time, what they did wrong and so on. Also, it talks about Amiga Technologies, which was their subsidiary.
Right, yeah, I remember those.
And that was head up by Petr Zajenko, who's the biggest tosser you've ever met in your life. But that's another story. But what happened is that this became the Commodore IPs, especially after ESCOM went, the Commodore IPs, the intellectual property, the logos, the trademarks, patents and so on. It was a whole lot of vultures trying to get a piece of the action, and there was loads of lawsuits, and people trying to develop new products, whether it be a new operating system or whether it be a new game. They'd suddenly get a cease and desist order come to them. You're not allowed to use that because you're using the logo, which we now own, and all this sort of stuff. But in spite of all of that, there were some incredible developments over the last few years, and that's what this book tells about, which is why it's called From Vultures to Vampires, because it's from the day when the vultures were in there getting little bits, and taking us through to the vampire, which is one of the latest technologies, which is a phenomenal technology. So it was a great title for the book, and I couldn't resist using the title for the book. But what's really interesting is that there is so much information. We've filled 360 pages, and we only got to the end of 2004. So now we're doing volume two, which takes us from 2005 up to today. I wrote to everybody who had been involved in some technical form since, and including Trevor Dickinson, of course, who's got AE on technology. And I got to all the other people who've got products, including the Vampire, the Apollo guys. And I said to them, I'm writing a book, and I want to talk about when you start and all the things that happen. But I also like your perspective from today. So it's a really, a broader perspective.
Yeah.
And of course, Trevor was one of the people I wrote to, and he wrote back to me and said, Dave, he said, how about I co-author with you? Because I've got loads and loads of material I've already gathered, which makes sense to me, and it makes my job easier. Yeah. And it's been really good because, the material he's got is so well researched and so on and so forth. It's been a bit difficult because obviously with COVID, he's in New Zealand and the time difference and everything else, but we seem to have managed it, and I'm very proud of the book. I really have to say, very proud of it. Volume 2, I'm planning to have it launched before Christmas. We're still writing it, so I literally took delivery of these books today. I literally unloaded them from the truck from Turkey to this morning before I drove here. So I've now got to ship them all out to all the Kickstarter backers and pre-orders and so on and so forth. But we have started on volume two. But my plan is to get it out so that people get it by Christmas. Well, that's probably the best I can do, to be honest with you.
Yeah, that's good. Sounds like a fascinating story. I've always wanted to know what happened to the whole Amiga intellectual property.
There's stuff on it. What I can tell you is that there is some technology that was developed that, if it had been released and produced, would have given the Amiga a completely different marketplace. Not just a home computer, all sorts of technology. And for one reason or another, these things just didn't happen. Yeah. But it's all in there, and I think people will be thrilled when they find out that could have happened, or what should have happened here,
Okay, really look forward to having a read of Volume 1 and Volume 2. So, right, we're losing light, so I think we'll thank you very much,
You're
David.
Very
Always
welcome.
A pleasure talking to you.
Thank you indeed, yes, thank you for the opportunity.
I'm sure we'll get to catch up
David
soon.
Pleasance.com. Anybody wants to pre-order or whatever, I've got everything on there. I've got the hardbacks, obviously. I've got e-books, and I've got actually, I'm getting books, both the books being translated, one into German, two into Spanish, and one into Italian. And they'll be available as e-books,
Wonderful.
Which I think a lot of people have been asking for.